Okay. It is 7:02, I'm gonna call this Arundel Planning Board normal meeting to order. On the agenda tonight, we have the approval of the agenda, approval of minutes for three different meetings that we've had. We have a public hearing with M. Welch and Sons for registration of an existing contractor yard two. Under pending applications, we have M. Welch and Sons registration of existing contractor yard. We have Champaign Energy Parking Lot Amendment to Site Plan Permit. In new applications, we have Bartlett Farms Two, an amendment to approve subdivision. And then under the ordinance revisions, we have some discussions about the fire protection ordinance and a discussion about amendments to the stormwater management performance standards. Gentlemen, I would like to move the Champaign Energy. Oh, yes, sorry. Marty, you need a roll call.
We haven't approved the agenda first.
No, and we haven't, but let's have the roll call and then I'll tell you what I wanna do with the agenda. This way, everybody will know that we have a quorum.
All right.
Tom McKinnon.
Jamie Lowery.
Rich Canong.
Roger Warren.
Ted Redway.
Thank you. I would like to move the Champaign Energy Parking Lot to after the new applications. This information did not come in until today. And it's my opinion, it shouldn't have made it to the agenda.
Okay.
Is that a motion?
That is a motion.
I'll second that.
Motion's been made and seconded, all those in favor? Opposed? Marty?
It looks like the way it is.
Okay. It's 4-1. Okay, I need approval of the agenda.
Make a motion to approve the agenda as amended.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded, any discussion? All those in favor? Unanimous. Minutes of August 11th.
Could we move those to the end rather than take the...
Yeah.
It's three different meetings to go through.
Okay.
I'll make a motion to...
Take the agenda?
Take that to the end.
Okay.
Probably should have put that on your agenda. All right, please, before we get into ordinance review.
Yeah, I'll get it. Motion has been made to...
I'll second that.
Made and seconded to table these until the, before the ordinance revisions. Any other discussion? All those in favor? Unanimous. Okay, it is 7:05, I'm going to call a public hearing for M. Welch and Sons registration of an existing contractor yard two. It's a request to register an existing contractor yard and construction business as a contractor yard two on a 30-acre site located at 24 Welch Lane, tax map 34, lot 1A in the R1 district. M. Welch and Sons is the applicant, Mark Welch is the owner. This is a public hearing. Does anyone from the public have any comments or questions? Yes, sir.
We're in a butter, and we're quite happy with the current situation, but what exactly does this re-registration mean?
Under the ordinance that
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman, could you identify yourself?
Please? Yes, sorry, Steve DL, which is spelled D-A-L-Z-E-L-L.
Okay, thank you, sir. Under the new ordinance, contractor yards that are currently in existence have to register in order to be able to continue to operate. And we notified all of the contractor yards of that effect. And Mark has been kind enough to come in and say, hey, I'm one and I want to register and come make sure that I'm in compliance with the ordinance. Mm-hmm. Is there anybody else that has any comments, any questions? Hearing none, I will close the public hearing at 7:06. And we will start with pending applications. The first one on the list is M. Welch and Sons, the registration of the existing contractor yard two. And I'm not going to read everything because I just said it a moment ago. Does the board have any questions? Anything for Mr. Welch? I think it's pretty straightforward. He's come in and he said, I've got a yard and I want to get on board with it.
And we did look at it at the last meeting and reviewed it, and everything is in great shape.
If you have any questions, feel free.
Are you planning to change anything you do?
No.
Well, which place we got now?
Opening food, more lorries.
What's that?
More lorries going into trucks.
Not right off the bat, nothing that I know of.
So why are you extending it then?
I don't think it's extending it, I think it's just making sure that it's all up to date.
Oh, yeah.
You're just bringing it into conformity with the ordinance.
Right, yeah.
Marty?
Just to make a note, he is the first one.
He is.
Out of them all in town.
Somebody wanna make a motion?
Yeah, I'll make a motion, we approve the request to register as to construct the ad. It's with no conditions.
Second.
Okay, motion has been made and seconded to approve the application. Any discussion?
There is a finding of fact.
Yes, there is.
Where?
Yes. And we have to go to that whole list. Is that included?
Yeah.
Where?
It's, should be right there in the package you got there.
Is that it?
It didn't provide.
Well, there should be a whole bunch there.
Yeah, they brought extras.
Draft edit, draft edit, draft edit. Yes.
Okay, here we go, yeah. Okay. Bear with us while I read this. Findings of fact and motion for approval, M. Welch and Sons contract this storage yard two designation. Whereas on September 22nd, 2016, the Arundel Planning Board received an application from M. Welch and Sons to register an existing contractor yard and construction business as a contractor yard two on a 30-acre site located at 24 Welch Lane, tax map 34, lot 18 in the R1 district. Whereas on September 22nd, 2016, the Planning Board determined the application complete and scheduled a public hearing for October 13th, 2016. Whereas on October 13th, 2016, the Planning Board conducted a public hearing in conformance with the Land Use Ordinance Section 97F1. And whereas the Arundel Planning Board has determined the following findings of fact and notice of decision. Findings of fact, number one, the owner of the property and the applicant is Mark Welch. Number two, the property is located at 24 Welch Lane, tax map 34, lot 1A in the R1 district. Number three, the current owner has operated an earth material storage facility and contractor staging yard on the site since 1985. The applicant has been receiving 3-year conditional use permits to operate an earth moving operation on the site since 2006. Number four, the assessor confirms that the operation has been assessed as a contractor staging yard and the applicant has personal property for the contractor use on the site. Number five, the applicant has provided a survey of existing conditions on the project site prepared by Post Road Surveying and dated July 21st, 2016, and the board has reviewed the operation for compliance with the qualifying criteria for a contractor yard two in the R1 district as specified in the Land Use Ordinance Section 82924 and has made the following findings. Number six, the property meets or exceeds space and bulk standards in the Land Use Ordinance 82924A. Number seven, the property meets the driveway setback requirements of Land Use Ordinance 82924B. Number eight, parking and storage areas are visually blocked from adjacent residential properties as required in Land Use Ordinance 82924C. Number nine, site lighting does not spill onto adjacent properties in accordance with Land Use Ordinance 82924D. Number 10, stockpiles of earth materials are stabilized or below gradient of surrounding properties, eliminating debris and odor nuisances in accordance with Land Use Ordinance 82924E. Number 11, the applicant does not have any asphalt paving equipment or supplies stored on site. Number 12, the hours of operation and employee parking conform to the requirements of sections Land Use Ordinance 82924G and H, conformance with conditional use criteria. After due review and consideration, the Arundel Planning Board has determined the application to be in conformance with the criteria of 97H of the Land Use Ordinance as follows. 97H1, that the property is compatible with and similar to general categories of uses of neighboring property. the existing operation conforms to the qualifying standards of land use 82924, and therefore is configured to have minimized impact on adjacent properties and the neighborhood.
Need to.
We need a motion.
Motion on each one?
On each one.
Chairman, you have another copy that I still need to get that.
Yep, give me the money.
I'll move we approve that.
I'll second that.
Motion has been made and seconded for 97H1. Any discussion? All those in favor? It is unanimous. 97H2. The use is consistent with the comprehensive plan and the anticipated future development of the neighborhood in that the 2014 and 2015 comprehensive plan update advocates the process of designating existing and legal contractor yards as conforming conditional uses in the residential districts. The registration of the M. Welch and Sons operation as a legal contractor yard too is therefore in conformance with the comprehensive plan.
Motion. Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor? It's unanimous. 97H3. That there is adequate and safe pedestrian and vehicular access to and into the site to accommodate anticipated traffic to and from the use. Welch Lane is more than adequate to accommodate the existing and even increasing vehicle traffic generated by the operation. Site distances along Limerick Road exceed requirements of the Land Use Ordinance 77A.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Yep.
97H4, that there is adequate water supply and sewage disposal available to service the use. The registration of the existing operation will have no adverse impact upon existing on-site well and septic systems serving the administration office.
So moved.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
It's unanimous. 97H5, that there will be no noise, dust, odor, vibration, or smoke generated by the use that will adversely affect neighboring properties, in that the applicant has long mitigated adverse dust, odor, and debris nuisances that could be generated by the stockpiled earth materials, and this has historically been in compliance with this requirement in all of his previous conditional use permit renewals. The town has not received any nuisance complaints from this operation from abutting property owners or the neighborhood.
So move.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any discussion?
Yeah.
Yeah, Marty.
You should turn around and say that a number of years since her non-complaints or anything else.
I don't know. I've only been here 5 years, so. Code enforcement officer has no record. So
I know, but I'm just saying for.
He's been here since 2000.
20 years plus. I'm just saying that is for a general.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep, we can make a note that there have been no complaints registered. Okay. All those in favor? So moved unanimous. 97H6, that the physical characteristics of the site include location, slope, soils, drainage, and vegetative cover are suitable for the proposed use. The proposed use will require limited alteration of the existing site topography. Tree cover will be retained on the perimeter of the site. The installation of stormwater detention basin along the northern boundary of the proposed building will capture runoff from the proposed. What?
What's this?
That's wrong, because there's no proposed building.
Scratch.
Yeah, that's scratch.
Okay. The physical characteristics of the site, including location, slope, soils, drainage, and vegetative cover, are suitable for the proposed use.
Period.
Period.
I'll make a motion on that, just that statement.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Yeah.
It is unanimous. 97H7, that the use will not constitute a public or private nuisance. No additional nuisances will be generated by the designation of the use of the contractor yard 2. Any substantial expansions of operations that trigger a conditional use review per the Land Use Ordinance 97B will be reviewed by the Planning Board.
So moved.
Second.
Motion been made and seconded. Any discussion? All in favor?
Yes.
Unanimous. 97H8. that all other requirements and applicable provisions of this ordinance, particularly any pertinent performance standards, are met. The applicant has met all pertinent portions of the Arundel land use ordinance in the designation of, in the design of the proposed facilities.
So moved. Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor? Unanimous. Therefore, be it resolved that based on the above findings and conclusions, the Arundel Planning Board hereby designates the M. Welch and Sons operation as a conforming contract DR2, subject to the operating conditions and limitations of Land Use Ordinance 829-4. The applicant is no longer required to file earth-moving permit renewals, and any major expansion of operation area is subject to Planning Board approval under the Land Use Regulations, so approved by the Arundel Planning Board this 13th day of October 2016.
We have Tom on a motion to approve this, and Marty on a second.
Any other discussion, gentlemen?
Just one minor glaring thing, second to last line, that operation area, something about that doesn't make sense.
Subject to the operating conditions and limitations of LUO 829-4.
And then the next one, the application is no longer required.
The applicant is no longer required to file earth-moving permit renewals, and any major expansion has to come before us.
Okay.
Okay?
Yeah.
Any other discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor?
Yeah.
It is unanimous. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you for being the first one.
You get a gold star. What's that? You get a gold star. That's a good one.
New applications.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bartlett Farms, amendment to an approved subdivision plan, a request to amend the condition number 5 of 2007 Bartlett Farms 2 subdivision to authorize the issuance of up to 25 building permits prior to the completion of all infrastructure improvements on the Bartlett Farms subdivision, Tamrock Drive, Tax Map 3, the R2 District. Northeast ABS Incorporated is the applicant owner, and Kurt Hissom is the agent. That is you.
That is me.
Do you have a presentation that you'd like to make?
Presentation that I'd like to make. Yeah, we're looking to build on the momentum that we've got. We've got one house under construction. We plan to start another one in November. We've got people interested in some lots that are a little further into the development, and a lot reservation on 19. And we would just like to be able to, you know, continue with that momentum and the, you know, the current strength in the real estate, and be able to offer houses to these customers.
Are you, when I look at this, you're asking for permission to do this prior to completion of the infrastructural improvements, which would have been part of the original plan?
Correct.
Okay.
The original plan, we offered to the town to complete 100% of the infrastructure before we asked for any building permits.
Okay.
And our feeling was at that time that if we did it in phases, that we would be turning away people, we would potentially be turning away people because people may want a lot further into the development. So at the time, the market was pretty good, and the economy was pretty good, so we spent all the time to put in the entire infrastructure up to probably the last 15%, and stopped there. Then Aaron Shields, the planner at the time, offered to allow us to pull 5 building permits, which we were appreciative of. We built one house in there, and then some number of years later, we built another house. So we've started in earnest building homes in there, and our objective is to build it out.
Does the board have any questions?
I have a question, sir. that there is, part of the reason for the phasing is just so that you could, maybe a cost saving to you, so you wouldn't have to extend the road all the way through. So I'm curious about the road and also the back egress of the road connecting back to Libby Acres.
Yeah, we stopped at, we had a small stockpile area at the end where we stopped the pavement. So we're paved to here. This is complete into about, this is a rough grade up to somewhere in here. And this connects into Liberty Acres.
Where's the phase?
We're working right here. So we've had a permit and house under construction on lot 9 and planning start on lot 8.
So this road is all complete?
This road is complete, paved, all of the fire systems are in, and up to right here.
Okay. Along with all the utilities and everything else. Right, thanks.
So my question, I wasn't on the board when this was originally approved. My question for those of you who were, what was the logic or the conversation behind limiting the building permits, as I understand it, to phase one until that road was cut through? Is that accurate?
No, we offered. In the planning process, we offered to build 100% of the infrastructure before we pulled one permit.
Yep.
And when we got into the construction of it, at the time, Mr. Shields was happy with what was being done out there, and he said, you know, you guys probably could amend the plan and get some number of permits if you'd like to, prior to having all of that infrastructure complete, which we took advantage of. So there wasn't, he came to us prior to us completing it and said, you know, you guys have put a tremendous amount of work into this. You can, if you'd like to pull some permits, you can amend the plan. So we did that for 5.
Okay. So the initial approval didn't have any stipulations on phasing, and
no,
you were just going to do the whole thing.
No,
and
correct.
I think I included the approvals in your packets. Originally, the 2006, excuse me if I jump in here, the 2006 approval had that stipulation in it, that you do all that work. And then the 2007 was the amendment that enabled them to put in the units that. And so what the applicant's asking to do is to amend the plan again, amend the conditions of the approval of that plan to allow them to start selling units based on the provisions in section 12.2b.2e.
Our plan is to start this fall on finishing the rest of the infrastructure. We just don't want to lose the momentum that we've got going right now. And start sending people away who have contacted us.
I don't know if I heard you right, Ted. In 2006, it was originally approved?
Yes.
Yeah, and it was changed in 2007.
Yeah.
You were there, Tom.
Yeah, so I'm wondering, what was the reason for the change in 2007?
They wanted to take advantage of to build some civil buildings at that time.
Initially, they had to be complete everything before they could sell houses.
Right. Yeah.
So then they came back and said, hey, listen, you know, if we stop up to here, can we go ahead and sell some houses? And we gave them the okay to do that. Oh, we, right. Wherever they presented it was.
It was, well, when you said up to here, where was that?
Where we were at the time. That's where we were completed to when we, as I remember, Mr. Shields came to us and said, you guys could probably amend the plan.
Okay. Great, thanks. Well, I'll just say, I see no reason not to allow it, because it's still, it can only build as long as you have a permit, as long as the road inspector has approved of and.
The infrastructure that's in has been all signed off on.
I really don't see any reason not to allow building as long as permits are available. Wherever.
I've got one, concern in that area, especially with. I'm glad you mentioned that you're looking to punch the rest of that road through. Are there any legal obstacles that you guys face? Land acquisition, anything like that? You've got all that free and clear, 100% Hissong?
Yes, we do.
Okay.
In KBS, Northeast KBS.
Sure, yeah. Right, sorry. Because, the intersection right there, cars coming out onto Old Alfred Road likely would head up to that intersection right there with Old Alfred and New Road, which is not the most pleasurable part of my day.
Your K intersection?
Correct.
Yeah.
We've been through that. That was certainly addressed in the original plan. And to my recollection, when the traffic study was done, basically what the guy determined was that intersection is so odd that that people really slow down for it. There are very, very few accidents there, from my understanding.
Not major ones, but there's a lot of small accidents.
As somebody that has gone through there, I can testify to the increase in traffic, at least anecdotally, from now than it was in 2006-07 time frame. So that's a concern of mine.
And people making left turns onto 111 from that intersection, a disaster.
Well, that's part of DOT's problem.
Right, that's...
Right, that's DOT's problem.
Exactly.
That wouldn't change whether it was all in phase one or spread out in other phases.
That wouldn't make any difference.
No, it wouldn't. It would just be that without the connection through, everything would have to head out to Old Alfred Road instead of having the option of going back up through the...
You can go Alfred Road and go right.
You could go right.
Yep. You can go to Mountain Road.
Yep.
Mark, my only question, you said you're going to finish that cut through to Liberty Acres.
We plan to finish the structure in its entirety over this winter.
So that, only reason I'm asking that is for the idea of if ever in the event, before it gets more populated than anything else, for fire.
Yeah.
That's the only reason I'm asking that question. So if anything did happen, you don't have to go take the long way around. That's all my question and concern was.
I agree. That's my one concern, that would be finished, opened up, so you'd have access, full access both ways.
John?
I don't know how this goes. I don't come to these meetings all the time.
That's okay.
So I'm just going to cut to the chase. I know that John Cody... on the butter. I know that originally I came to these meetings when he first proposed his development, and this was the discussion we were having right then and there about traffic, Route 111, New Road, and Old Alfred Road melding in the same spot, and that was why, or one of the main reasons why, they wanted the road completed, the infrastructure completed, prior to selling houses in there, so that you had an avenue to get in and out both ways. You weren't trapped with a one-way exit in a development, for whatever reason, trees down, power lines, whatever, you had access, egress, two ways, not one way. And it mitigated some of the traffic at the old Alfred Road, 111, which has become extremely busy, and the new road. Like you said, trying to make a left turn of any kind onto 111 is almost a nightmare these days. Not his problem, but it was discussed in 2006, and that was nearly the traffic we have today. So all I'm asking, and I don't mind if he builds houses, but I think he should finish the infrastructure before he builds a house. That's my opinion. For that one reason, say.
Sorry, John. How many building permits, if they came in and asked for 50 building permits, how much would the town allow?
From what perspective?
If they show up on January 1st and say they want to...
That isn't going to happen.
I know it's not. I'm making a hypothetical. They want to apply for 50 building permits. How many would the town...
Under the current conditions, none, because they're still under that restriction that they cannot pull more building permits beyond the five.
So I can pull two.
So if you pull two more.
If that was lifted, how many could they...
Their limitation would be on both ordinance. That's about it. You have 42 lots altogether.
There's 42 lots in Bartlett Farms too.
Right. And you have built on...
And we have built... We have three permits pulled.
What I'm trying to weigh is these guys are saying their intent is to get this done fairly rapidly. Mm-hmm. What's the likelihood that doesn't get finished and we've opened it up to allow for 20 more building permits? Is that gonna be a possibility?
But there's also a restriction on how many building permits one builder pulled up.
Right. Yeah,
that's what I'm trying to understand.
Yeah, in the staff notes, what I told you was that basically, if we use the conservative ITV trip generation calculation for single family homes, basically the ordinance is subdivision ordinance, aside from the conditions you put on this one, that would allow 250 trips before you have to say I have a second means of egress.
Right.
I understand that. 10 trips per day, yep. 25 houses.
Right. No, that's all clear. Right. But how many, what I'm trying to assess is if they wanted to come in and start getting building permits next month, how many could they obtain a reasonable, foreseeable type of completion to the road?
There is something in the growth ordinance, yes, that restricts the number of permits that you can get on a per month basis, isn't it?
Yes.
To what? Is it two or three? Do you know right off the top of my head? Is it two, Marty?
Yes. That's okay. Why I was
So he's restricted to two, so it would take him the entire year just to come up with the 25.
Right.
But that's, okay. Yeah, that's, I thought it was two, but wasn't sure.
It's two, but it's also a limitation of how many one developer can get at one time.
That's right.
Yeah. Off the top of my head, I don't know.
We have one cycle into that, basically.
The end of, yeah, it's okay. The end of the end. There's an allocation to ensure that it doesn't all get doubled up by one piece.
And that's where I was going with my question of...
Are they going to do 25 in one year if they had the market done? They couldn't get the permits for 25 here. The growth ordinance would kick in.
The question what you're getting at, you want the infrastructure done before we get that far down the road? Well, I mean...
Which?
Well, exactly.
That's part of the current ordinance would require, and it's something that we need to address because given that this is an amendment, the current ordinance would require posting a surety bond to guarantee the completion of the infrastructure.
Yeah. Oh, unless, was that included in the original bond?
No, there was a bond originally, but that was released, and basically the town took the requirement that all infrastructure was going to be completed and approved prior to the issuance of building permit as a surety. In this particular case, we would have to have some sort of surety for them to go beyond that.
But it wouldn't have to necessarily be the amount that you put stated that they originally posted.
No, it's whatever it takes to finish it.
Right. Right.
So it would tell us basically how much that would be. And their engineer, or we would make an estimate on how much
much that would be, close to surety, if the planning board proceeds with this, and then you go, I don't know.
You'd end up drawing down against that surety as the work was completed.
You could do a...
But it's a way to guarantee that, for whatever reason, the sun fails to come up in the east, and you need to have, you walk away, we can finish the infrastructure from a town point of view.
Again, my plan is to finish the infrastructure over this winter. To start, we have a job finishing water line in Kenny Bunk, which should be done in the next 2 weeks. And my plan is to move my crew to Bartlett Farms.
Do you think you would progress enough to get a...
It's gonna take some 2 or 3 months.
So probably paving in the spring?
Paving in the spring, because I'll miss that one.
Right, that's what I was...
The plant's closed in another month.
Well, right, that's what I...
We love to see...
You guys have done a good job back in there, I mean, commend you for that.
I did my sound culture.
You got a question?
Yes, just a quick question for Mr. Hassan. You've got, how close is the furthest house, closest to Liberty Acres, how close is it? Is there any that's real close to that section that you have for sale, that you wanna build on?
How close to, no. We have people who are interested as far as the first road on the right.
Yeah, okay.
So it's well before the intersection is built to Liberty Acres.
You got another question?
Yes, sir.
So can the board, like, give him a time period or a timeframe, like X amount of permits can be given out, you know, up to a certain point if he hasn't completed the rest of the infrastructure as stated?
Well, he's asking for 25 right now. We could modify that and say that some other...
I'm asking for 25 total. We already have 5.
Okay.
Right, so an additional 20.
An additional 20.
So, but can the board do like they did in the past, say we'll issue you 5 permits, but none will be issued till the remainder of the infrastructure has been completed? If he says it's gonna be completed in the spring, then it should be no issue, you know?
That is a possibility.
Or limit it to a certain amount of time, where he says, oh, I'll be done in April, which, you know, maybe that's 5 months from now, so a max of 10 permits, it can only be issued 2 a month. And it's a good, if he's planning on doing it, should be no issue. He should have no problem with that. If he's saying he's gonna do it over the winter and it's gonna be done in the spring, then he should have no issue, you know, with getting an approval to get X amount of permits within a certain period of time. If he completes the infrastructure, fantastic. He gets all his permits, hallelujah. If he doesn't, well, then he's gotta come back here again.
Well, that would be one of the reasons that we would request the surety bond, to make sure that the infrastructure was complete, so that if he doesn't finish it...
Well, I'd hate to see him build...
We'd put poor Roger back there to work.
25 houses with still only one entrance in and out. This would be my concern.
Yep. I'm sure that would be the chief's concern as well.
Yes.
How to get an ambulance in there or a fire truck or something.
Yes, against a construction fire, that would be an issue. These are the discussions we had, because you know as well as I do, having been on the fire department, mm-hmm. and a major house fire, there's no way, after you put all this equipment on the road, there's no other way out of there. And if you had a little fire or something and it started, the wind was blowing right, it'd be blowing right to the people. Where are they gonna go? They're gonna abandon everything and start running through the woods. So these are safety concerns.
Those same things
extreme,
happen
but
at many other developments as well.
Yes.
Talbot Woods is 21 or 22 lots with one.
Yep, there are.
Mm-hmm. And there's, you know, it's the same issue there.
Anything else from the board? I have a couple of things. One, I was concerned about the surety bond for the subdivision. But this appears to indicate, from back in 2006, 2007, that the town may end up assuming responsibility for the roads. You may be coming to the town, to town meeting and requesting that they.
We would certainly petition the town to take the roads over.
Okay, that's, I wanted to make sure I was reading it correctly.
Was that the original intention of the subdivision, to do a public road?
Correct.
Okay. The other question I had.
There's not still a bond or a line of credit or something that's attached to this?
No, it was released.
Okay.
John Fraser released, he had a half million dollar letter of credit that was released back in 2000, at the end of 2006.
Okay.
Okay, so that's covered, so we need to supplement the remainder of the work.
And that's, which brings me to the other question. I'm looking at it in an agreement in 2006. It says that the applicant will pay the town the total amount of $50,000, which shall be paid ratably per lot in installments of $1,190.48 per lot, with each lot payment to be paid at or prior to the closing or transfer of each lot.
So, impact fee.
Right, okay. Yeah, I haven't seen them before.
Because you don't have an ordinance for it.
Well, we tried to persuade the Board of Selectmen to do that. We didn't get anywhere. But okay, I just wanted to, I saw that and I thought, oh, that's good.
Not to wait for it.
No.
Okay, that answers my question. Anybody from the public have any questions for Mr. Hissong?
Through the chair?
Yes.
You have to have a public hearing.
Yes. But I figured we could ask questions now if people have.
Yeah, who are present?
Those that are present, yes. But I know that a lot of the abutters are here.
I know, but still.
And you'll all get a notice that we're going to have a public hearing.
So I guess it's going to be the same questions.
All abutters.
When you're going to.
Of the application.
Okay.
Okay, so they've already received a notice that this application has been.
Okay.
So you want to schedule a public hearing?
Let's schedule a public hearing.
That will be during the next meeting, which is the 27th.
October 27th, that work for everybody? Do a public hearing?
Do you have enough time?
14 days?
Today's 13th. That's 27th, so.
14 days.
If you can get it posted.
Well, yeah, that's the question.
That's the question of posting. Or does it need a 10-day posting? Or is it a 14-day posting?
I'll check, no, it's not 14 days. That's only for, that's only for ordinance revisions. 14 days is, 14 days of actual posting.
What is it? Is it 10 days for the public hearing?
No, 7 days.
7 days for the public hearing. So we have plenty of time to do that.
I'll go back and actually see.
Should let you know, I won't be able to make it on the 27th.
I'll be in DC on the 27th. I will.
So that's down, so here is, that's down before right there, so we may want
to push it to the, the sole meeting in November. Yeah. Which I believe is what, the 16th?
Could be the 17th.
The 8th is on a Tuesday, and that's voting election day.
Yes, the 16th is on a
Tuesday.
It's not a Thursday. We're going to go Thursday. So
yeah, oh, no, I'm just measuring in time. So we're looking at the 17th.
Is there, can existing members here make a commitment to be there at the calendar?
Right. Two of us are around. That's my concern. If these two we know aren't, then that leaves the remaining four board members.
Yeah, Chip would have to be there.
Yeah, I mean, do we want to schedule that as a public hearing if we then don't have a quorum?
Well, only those four can vote. basically are at the public hearing, and it's a condition vote.
I agree.
Well, I'm not stressed about voting, I'm stressed about having to have a public hearing and turning people away.
Not having them show up.
Right.
Unless we have a new member appointed.
That won't happen until.
I'm just saying.
I think we should. Push it back till the tenth.
It's the tenth.
Is it the tenth?
It's the tenth.
Okay.
Is that what you want, is that the motion?
No, I'll take my motion to make a public hearing for November tenth.
Sorry, yeah.
Okay, motion's been made and seconded to have a public hearing on November tenth. Any other discussion?
Yeah, I'll be there on the twenty-seventh.
So.
That's okay.
Kirk.
Like I'm always in.
This won't affect your ability to finish.
What I have currently.
Yeah, finish the road, so.
Okay. All those in favor?
Yeah.
Unanimous.
Rick, can you give me, in that meantime, could you come up with the cost of?
Of the road, of the rest of the road, you see?
Next item, Champagne Energy.
See you in a month.
Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Good evening, members of the board. My name is Amy McNally, I'm an attorney with Woodman Edmonds, and I'm here representing Champagne Energy. I give you guys a minute if you're still checking in front of me. I appreciate you being willing to hear from us tonight. Mr. Millet, Craig Millet, is also here, the vice president of Champagne Energy. We were here on September 9th to discuss a revised plan for a buffer on Champagne's property located at 833 Post Road. And then before we kind of get back to that plan, I'd like to provide some kind of background for the board. I think the conversation from last meeting could continue with this background more effectively. Back in September 2015, Champagne Energy had a plan approved for a commercial parking lot with a buffer along the Post Road, which comprised about 20 feet of buffer on Champagne's property, and then about 20 feet of that buffer on the town's right-of-way. And so that is what the plan called for. Since then, that buffer has been removed, and it's our understanding, and I believe that some representatives from the town here to follow up on this, is that the town's right-of-way, the buffer or vegetation in the town's right-of-way was removed during highway maintenance, and also that highway maintenance encroached into the 20-foot of buffer that Champagne's was entitled, or excuse me, responsible for. So that buffer has been removed, but I think some of the impressions from the last meeting was that Champagne's Energy was solely responsible for that. And I think having that background information, I'd also like to bring the attention back to the proposal that myself and Tom Emery spoke about last meeting on the 9th. We have since added a letter from Tom Emery, who is a certified or licensed landscape architect, who kind of goes through step by step how this new proposed buffer will meet the standards of the ordinance as for screening from the residential neighbors and meeting that 76% or greater requirement under that ordinance. And I think actually Tom does explain in his letter that it's actually more substantial than the original plan. It's actually 4 feet higher to start with, that buffer. So in reality, it's actually more sufficient or more detailed than the original site plan. And again, this is also Mr. Millet through Champagne Energy compensating for something that was too largely out of his control, something that was done through highway maintenance in large part. And so he's actually recouping financially and otherwise for that at this point. So we would like to turn the board's attention back to this plan that we've proposed with the addition of Mr. Emery's letter, indicating that it's his position as a licensed landscape architect that it does comply with the ordinance as proposed, and that would meet the buffering requirements of the 76% or greater from the residential abutters. So I understand there's representatives of the town again to hear that may be able to find. Provide the board some feedback as to kind of the how and when this buffer was removed, but I think that is an important piece to this conversation. And again, our client has proposed through this landscape architect, a plan that meets the ordinance, and that's what we're asking the board to turn their attention to. I'm happy to field questions again. Mr. Miller is here, and thank you very much.
Does the board have any questions?
I wasn't present at the meeting. I was out of town. So, I mean, out of the way.
I very much would be interested in Roger's take, given that...
He just got thrown under the bus?
Yeah, given that new piece of information.
We went down there, we cut the whole road, so this little area wasn't singled out. From one end to the other, we had Kenny Monk's crew with us. We did some time sharing with them and Kenny Monk as well. And we cut that back to the right-of-way so we could establish a ditch line there. There was water running right into the road. There was no ditch line there. We went in this spring after, well, it was actually this summer, with the whole ram, busted up some ledge to establish a ditch line. That road is not even close to being in the center of the right-of-way, so what you think you had for a buffer, that might have been anyone thinking that it's in the private way, it was actually in the public way. We have followed the pins down there. We flagged it out. Keith has since been down there with us. What we cut, primarily with the exception of a few, there was a few that we cut. When you cut a group of small trees and stuff, if it's leaning up over the right of way, what do you do? Draw a magic line through the sky and cut it off and leave it that way? So some will cut, yes, no question. But the rest of that was done to establish a ditch line through that, to drain the road. It wasn't a safe condition.
But you didn't go through and clear cut all of that property. You just cut the town property.
We cut to the right of way.
Yeah, okay.
But again, that right of way is, that road is not in the center of the right of way. So if you go down there and measure 25 feet off the center of the road, you're going to go another 10 feet to get to the edge of the right of way.
And I believe that shows that on the plan.
That it does.
Yeah, it showed it on the...
He did, yeah. The survey
and the SG did show that the right of way was... The actual road was skewed way to the east on that right.
But the plan of the site, notwithstanding anything outside of the property boundaries of Champaign, still had some amount of landscape buffer that was retained within the property, regardless of whatever Roger did within the right of way.
The only thing, the plan would put no stipulations on the town.
Correct. No, we don't. We wouldn't.
They only required a 20-foot buffer from their property line in to their property. That's it. That was the requirement for Champaign to put in that, to retain the existing vegetation, because they were given the choice of doing it.
And that, I assume, based on what Roger's saying, was cut down by Champaign's doings.
My understanding is it was a side effect of the construction, correct?
Roger, was that cut, was that, let me ask you a question, was that parking lot already constructed in place by the time you guys started your work?
I don't know that it was complete. It was pretty much,
done.
What percentage?
Okay. And you did your cutting when?
Then you did.
I've said this before, a mistake was made, but we just have to move forward and fix the problem. That we were presented with a plan that I'm comfortable with. I'm not sure if anybody would, not all of us agreed with that. But I wonder, so where do we go from here?
Well, I believe that the planning board gave Tom Emery a different direction to look at it, doing a naturalized buffer instead of the arborvitae buffer. And we had not received any that request or anything else until today. So I haven't gone over that plan, what Tom Emery has said. We don't have a plan other than what they originally submitted. So the question to the board is, the request that was made by the board at the last meeting has not been met. Where do you want to go with that?
That's what we have. It's dated back in August. afterwards, September, to discuss all of this. And they were then told that there would be a different set of plans coming out, but we haven't gotten, which is why you guys have not been on the agenda. We have been waiting for information concerning the changes that we told to Mr. Emery and to Alan. Is it Alan? Is that his name? Okay, I can't remember. No, that Dylan wasn't there.
Yeah, it was just the landscape architect and the attorney.
Okay, then, but we haven't heard anything back, and then we got a letter today.
Correct, and I think some of the feedback was whether this plan from a landscape architect's perspective would meet the ordinance. And the fact is that it does. And that's, he's indicated it, he's put it in writing. I think that's the board's role at this point, if it meets the ordinance or not. I mean, that's kind of the scope we're working under here. And so that's the position right now, is that we presented a plan that meets the ordinance, and we'd like to move forward with that plan. And that's, you know, that's really what we're asking the board to decide, is whether or not this plan as presented meets the ordinance, so that we can move forward with this buffering.
So I'm gonna reiterate my comment from the last meeting, and the proposed arborvitae buffer was, in essence, made in different tree heights, different, you know, nuances to it, but in essence was proposed by the applicant when they came forward to us however many months ago. Through our deliberations, through our feedback with the with public comment, it was decided by the board to, the preference by the board was with the natural buffer that remained, notwithstanding anything that was outside of the applicant's property. And it just doesn't sit well that all of a sudden everything, I'm looking at this, and there still appears to be a substantial, on this plan, substantial amount of tree growth within the Champagne property that was removed, that it just doesn't sit well, and it doesn't smell right.
Can I respond to that? My recollection is that we didn't care what type of screening and buffer they done. Some of the options were to put a fence there, put new arborvitaes in, and we left that then. We didn't reject a plan. We just approved of a plan to leave the natural buffer as is.
Well, the plan to leave the natural buffer, was it their suggestion? They
wasn't
said
their that, suggestion.
No,
it was
no they. We talked about it. They had originally come in with something that looks almost identical to this, and we had said, when we went out and did the sidewalk, they said, we're going to leave the natural buffer. We're going to leave that 20-foot strip of trees up, and we thought it was wonderful.
I remember it differently. I remember the neighbor saying, I don't want the arborvitaes, and the applicant saying, well, we that's our plan, but if you want, we'll go with the natural buffer. So they didn't propose that to us. It kind of evolved into that based on negotiating between us, the neighbors, and the applicant. And that seemed like a pretty good resolution. And unfortunately, there were some cutting that went a little too far. I can't hold that type of plan against the applicant. They originally had that, but it was requested that they not keep that type of plan.
And part of my issue is they agreed to that. They agreed that was, you know, that was okay with them. That's how they were going to move forward with this project. And lo and behold, through the course of time, that's been changed.
I think it was, I can understand the mistake where if they measured thinking the property line I don't know if it was
was surveyed, if they had pins in the right place, but the miners just assumed, well, there's 10 more feet that's by the buffer, and they shouldn't have counted that.
And I don't know what transpired, I wasn't there to watch.
Right.
Roger go through and do his cutting, and then watch the Champagnes go through and clear cut. Our position, once we found out about it, was that you have to meet the requirements of the ordinance. You've got to put in a berm and trees, and you have to buffer that. And if this plan meets that requirement, I'm quite happy with that plan. I want to see a plan. This is not a plan. This is a sketch drawing. We're supposed to have 10 of these delivered to us under the ordinance.
Well, we'll get 10 copies, but I haven't seen this.
The plan was originally proposed.
This was delivered today.
Right, yeah, and I'm not aware what that, I haven't seen it yet.
It was emailed and I printed it off at my house about an hour before it came.
Okay.
Question from the attorney.
Yes, ma'am.
If I may, I'm sorry. It's the identical plan that was provided in August. So it has been submitted. There is an official plan on the table for consideration from the board. Just for clarification.
Okay, thank you. I did not realize that this was
Was from as a courtesy, Tom appended it to his letter just for convenience purposes.
But according to his letter, this will meet the requirements of the ordinance. That's what we want it done. My whole problem with this is that, first off, you threw Roger under the bus. I don't think it was Roger's fault.
My apologies, officially, Roger.
And the other problem I have is that when we met with the applicant and we met with the abutters, if the Champagnes did not want to do that, if they wanted to do this whole thing with the arborvitae, they should have said so.
You were being good neighbors. Well, that's the way I saw it.
Okay. Being good neighbors does not mean you clear cut everything afterward and do what you wanted anyway.
If I come to you and say I'm gonna build a purple house, and we say
they did something wrong, but they have a plan to us that doesn't meet what we're asking.
It does meet what we're asking.
Well, gentlemen, I think if I may, okay. I mean, the issue is that they are coming in with a remedial plan.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
That's really what we've got to deal with. A request was made to see a more naturalized approach, so it wasn't a uniform hedge, essentially. The applicant has basically said they were not going to do that. So that's the first thing that the board should recognize. The second thing is, the same disputes that we had last time still exist, in the sense that this will not provide 100% buffering when it's planted as it is. The plan shows that initially, unless the vegetation or the berm is increased in size. We also had some concerns about what the topography was going to do here, and we only have one section instead of multiple sections like we asked for. We have one section in one location instead of several sections going from that viewpoint. And we had there's absolutely nothing done on the Swallow property. Or the Townsend property, which was next door, which is also affected by this. We only have it from the Toussaint property, so it needs a little bit more tweaking, unless the board wants to accept not total blockage at planting, like the ordinance requests.
So what I would suggest, you know, through the chair and for the board's consideration, you're very knowledgeable of the. You've heard our comments. You're knowledgeable of the landscape standards. Working with the landscape architect, provide some feedback, comments to the landscape architect on your review of what they've submitted. Have them submit appropriately.
All right, so you want me to work with Mr. Emery to come up with a solution that each one 100%
or 75%. Comment within the ordinance on what they have proposed.
Yeah, I think we recognized back in September we're never going to get 100%. We're never going to get the 100%.
If we're talking 75%,
that's the ordinance requires 76 to 100.
Exactly.
So when it's done, it has to meet the 76%. At that point, that doesn't mean that that the neighbors should have to wait 3 to 5 years for it to get to 76. It has to be at 76 on day one.
Maybe tough to do this year.
But that's okay. It can, as long as it's part of the plan and it's worked out, and we get it established. Marty?
One thing along the way, like I said, I wasn't at the September meeting, but one of the things also, the neighbors, okay, and I don't know if this has been addressed or not along the way, was about the lighting and shining into that. Has any of that been addressed from the time that we had met in August to present to try to deflect some of the glare or anything else?
They did say that they were going to put some kind of shielding on the lights, but I don't know.
My question is, has anything been shielded to the present?
I don't know.
I don't know. That's why my question is, because they were talking about...
It has nothing to do with the vegetation, though.
It's part of the...
It was still part of the buffer.
It's part of the buffer, because...
With the original buffer up there, with the original landscape, those lights never would have gotten through the house.
The request we had is they parked the trucks in a different parallel to the road.
No, these were, there was the issue with the trucks, but there were some of the lights themselves on the poles that they were supposed to be doing something with.
That's my question, though.
Okay.
And I think, quite frankly, gentlemen, when the buffer goes in, those lights will be shielded.
Yeah.
Given their current plan, I would say, given the height of those lights, they would probably be shielded. They had made mention of the glare from light, basically the light spillover because of the lack of the larger buffer that's there. And that was something the board asked them to look at, asked Champaign to look at. I don't have anything specific on that right now.
I'm not clear what we're asking them to do. You're going to work with them, but on what?
Well, let me ask the board. Are you satisfied with one section, one viewpoint, instead of multiples and from the other property, the Townsend property? Because we only have it from one property.
I think it needs to be from both properties, the Townsend Swallow and the Tucson.
Oh, that's what you're requesting.
Yes.
Had a plan view schematic been provided as well? I know
yes.
We had the...
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, that was...
Yes.
That was provided.
So, I'm wondering, anyone like at a little bigger scale than...
Yeah, I guess that would
be... Have to use an electron microscope to see.
Sure, I don't know if it'd be helpful over visually right now. I have some extra
Yes. No, it was a complete plan. There is a landscape planting plan that has quantities and sizes and species, specimens.
It's
called out. It's all called out, yeah. That's there. The issue is just, are they tall enough and given several viewpoints? It looks like they will make, I think they'll make 76 from the Townsend, from that straight section. If we do a section over here, we do a section from the Townsend property, we don't have a section from the Townsend property. We can't do, you can do multiple sections, sections every 5 degrees, that's a waste of time. But representative sections, I think, are what is necessary in addressing the lighting.
Mm-hmm.
And if anybody wants to swing by there tonight after the meeting, take a look and see how bad that is. It wouldn't be a bad idea. If it is, it even exists.
Yeah,
it's
so, dark time.
So I'll just restate, I'd like for you to, through the board and at the board's concurrence, do a review of what they've submitted and provide a comment.
Well, I already did that last time.
Oh.
I guess my question would be, I would, if you want, I will reach out to the LA and sit down and work with them and come back with this.
Was one of your comments to him the additional?
I think that's the concern, because this clearly states that from the Tucson property, the 76% will be reached. I want to know that it's going to be reached from the Townsend Swallows property as well.
And I would just like to clarify, would that be able to be done through a similar cross-section?
Yeah.
Informally from Tom to you?
It's done in cross-sections. It's basic geometry, that's really all it is.
So you just need that one additional piece?
Well, multiple. You need to do it from Townsend, you probably do three from each location. It's pretty easy stuff to do, actually. Because you have you know what the vegetation height is going to be based on the contours that are already there. So that's pretty easy. You know what you're going to put it in, and so it's just now. Yes, sir?
Can I bring up something that we've had the surveyors come back? 40 feet was left. I mean, did it go to 37 or 35 in a few spots? 40 feet was left. We did not touch it.
I'm not sure I understand. That property's been clear cut. And I don't think that, the town didn't do all of it.
We took 20 feet. We left 20 feet on the side of the buffer. And it's clear, if you go down there, you can see what we won versus what was cut last February. No complaints were made in November, December, January, until February. So we've taken the time to have a surveyor come down, measure from what the points that he has off the road, and it was there. It's very clear that it was there.
I'm not sure I understand. What are you saying was there? We did a sidewalk and there was no buffer going off Old Post Road.
Champagne's left 40 feet.
What kind of wood that there that had been cut? Were you saying the 40 feet would look like champagne?
Is there a few spots that were 37, 35?
Yeah, we're not going to argue about it. Our point is when we went down there and we did a sidewalk, it was completely clear cut.
You, town, cut it.
I do not believe the town went onto private property and
everything
cut the
everything that is cut there, you can clearly see what we want. The room is there. We didn't take a chainsaw back out there from February to now.
But we have a lawn in the buffer, designated buffer area. There's a lawn in the designated buffer area. The town right-of-way, according to your own surveyor's map, is 20 feet from the edge of the road. So everything from 20 feet along the edge of the road in, there should be another 20 feet of untouched vegetation.
Right, so that's what I'm saying.
But the you're saying the town 40 feet cut right 40 now. Feet of...
And if you look at the pins to where we lawn, like I said, it might be...
But I guess the question I would ask is that, first thing, Roger, did you grub any stumps that you cut? Any vegetation you cut, did you grub them all out?
In the ditch line, yeah.
In the ditch line, but outside of the ditch line?
No.
So the stumps that are left there, you left there?
Yeah.
Okay. So that was the extent of your cutting, was basically, it's shown,
well, we cut the stumps still
shown by the
with the exception of the ditch line.
Right, okay. So the thing is, I've done some measurements there, and I'm seeing basically the stumps pretty much in the 20-foot area. There's a couple that are over the 20-foot, but they're small caliber stuff. And there's some large trees that were identified by your engineer within your designated buffer area that are not there. And there's no stumps there that I can't speak to. I can't speak to who cut it.
Okay, so you will.
I was going to say, we never cut any trees from after November. There was no complaints. We finished that parking lot, I believe, on November 9th. No complaints.
And I think it's important. I think it's just important in the bigger scheme that there was a 40-foot buffer, a naturalized one. And when you take 20 feet out of that, that's when, you know, the buffering is eliminated, you know, is really the crux of it.
The only thing I would say to you is that this board did not put any responsibility on the town.
Sure, sure, sure.
So they were actually, if you think about it, they were only required to provide 20 feet of buffer. Whether that was gonna be effective or not was immaterial. That's all they were committed to respond to do.
And so in, then the other side of that is now they're proposing an effective 20-foot buffer. So, like, you know, the remedial plan is actually better than the original. And, you know, our client is really working hard to bring that to the council. So that's where we're at.
Understood.
So, yeah, if you can touch base with Mr. Emery and get the cross-sections to make sure that it meets the ordinance requirements for both pieces of property. I'm not sure. Yes, Dan?
Would it make sense for the town planner and the landscape and this gentleman to go to the property and maybe get Roger involved and go get this squared away so that we know exactly what's going on? So these guys don't have to keep coming back and forth here?
Well, we can do that, but I think the issue right here is doing the solution, getting a solution done. I mean, I'm kind of focused on that. If the applicant has got some concerns that the town has done some damage there, I mean, that is something that certainly they can take up with the administration, but I mean, we're dealing with a planning board issue here.
Yeah, but to my point is, if these guys come in with a solution and then you guys are gonna hash this all over again, to me, you know, we wanna make sure that, get these guys moving on here, right? If you feel comfortable that their solution is gonna work.
Well, that's what I'm gonna do.
Yeah, that's why he's gonna talk to the council.
Third meeting that I've been to that we've been hashing over this.
I think that would be the concern.
I missed the planning season, I would have this done by now, I missed the two, so I'm probably happy, we wouldn't be dealing with any of this, but I started this in May. I proposed this back in May.
I just wanted to add one more thing. From what we were asking, for last time, I thought that letter would document what we were looking for.
This letter does meet what we're looking for from the Toussaint property, but what about the other neighbor? If they come back with cross-sections from the landscape architect that says, yes, it meets it from the Swallows.
Townsend
property, then I think we're happy, because it does provide the buffer that it's supposed to provide. We just don't know if it meets it from the Townsend property right now. We know it meets it from Toussaint.
Well, from that one.
How is it gonna change from one house to the other?
Elevational differences.
And Toussaint's house sits higher.
Fine, then it's showing.
It should be easy.
Yeah, it should be easy.
I thought we did that.
No, you didn't, you only did one line, you did one section. You did one view in one location and it was in the letter that was sent, the planning board sent was specifically dealing with two properties. Because the Townsend property was affected as well. So that's why we mentioned in that with Alan and the letter we sent to you folks was that there were two properties involved and the concern was to take multiple viewpoints. That's it.
Anything else from the board? Do you understand what we're looking for?
Yeah, I mean, it sounds like something we do rather formally, and then it would be put forward or we would go back to the board whenever it's back.
Yep.
Okay. I mean, as long as that's the case.
Yep. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Acceptance of minutes. August 11th.
Yep.
I'm sorry, Tom, but you weren't here for that.
Oh, that's the one. Yeah, okay. I'm not on the other one either.
He watched the tape.
He watched it. Okay, there you go.
You guys did a good job.
Question on August 11th. Has it been resolved of what mini storage is doing, or has it been completed?
Does it have a committee?
Yeah.
You guys approved it?
Yeah.
Approved it.
You may not have been
at the meeting. You weren't at the meeting.
That's why I'm asking a question.
Yep, yep. That was approved. In fact, that's in, I think, September 22nd.
Okay, I'll make a motion to approve the minutes of August 11th.
Motion has been made, is there a second?
Yeah.
Motion's been made and seconded.
More than 20.
To approve the minutes of August 11th. All those in favor?
And those who are here.
Three in favor, two abstentions.
Jimmy abstained?
No.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, it was common either way.
Yeah, right.
Okay, September.
September 9th, I am not listed as attending, but I was there. First approval.
Yeah, first approval says.
He was, yeah.
Yes, it does, wow.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So I, is that, and then.
September the 9th?
September 8th.
And then on page four, just happened to be Champaign Energy. It says it's the same, the plan is essentially the same plan that the planning board rejected in the initial application.
Correct.
And I'm questioning the term rejected.
Yeah.
We didn't reject, we just went along with another option. So.
Suggested.
The plan, I think maybe it was essentially the same one that was proposed originally, but we didn't reject it.
Oh, you are. I'm looking for that as well, I don't see where it is.
It's towards the bottom of page four. Mr. Lowery is the person.
Mr. Lowery stated?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what it said.
Yeah, the second line.
Oh, okay.
The planning board rejected the initial application.
Yeah, but that's what Mr. Lowery said.
Did Mr. Lowery say that?
Yeah.
Are you sure? Because Mr. Lowery's not. I couldn't tell you what I said 2 minutes ago.
What makes this like?
A month ago.
I can vouch for that.
Okay, so.
Okay.
So if you said that, I'm comfortable with it.
Okay.
At the planning board.
What do you want me to say instead?
That was.
Congressional record.
Was it business for them?
It was essentially the same, that was presented to the planning board.
Initially presented.
Because I probably shouldn't have spoke so strongly if I did.
Okay.
It's on the record. Then we'll go to the tapers.
So with those.
You'll have to suffer through a lot of watching.
Well, I'll make a motion with that change and then my name added as attending. We approve.
Okay.
The minutes of September 8th.
For a second?
I'll second that.
Motion's been made and seconded, all those in favor?
One abstention.
Yep, four in favor, one abstention. September 22nd.
Move to approve that as ready.
Motion has been made, is there a second?
Nothing to do last minute.
Guess not.
Office hours slow.
It's good way of getting, so I'm there for you.
Yeah, this solves that problem, doesn't it?
All right.
I need a second.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded to approve the minutes of September 22nd.
Yeah.
All those in favor? Four in favor, one abstention.
Oh.
Okay. Ordinance revisions.
Question, Mr. Chair.
Yes, sir.
Before we came in, there was different ones here on the rental commercial people. Landowner and everything else. Where is the status of that on Commercial Drive?
They asked to be removed from the agenda because they still had not.
That well issue hasn't been resolved.
Okay. So until that's resolved.
I'm just asking a question.
Okay, ordinance revision. Proposed fire protection performance standards and modifications to the land use and subdivision ordinance. You should all have copies.
Did we have anything new on stormwater?
No.
I gas, we're gonna continue slugging your way through that.
I don't have that. I looked at the fire protection and public safety ordinance, and the only thing that I saw in here that I did not like is on, at the very bottom of page three, exemptions and additions. The fire chief or his or her designee may provide exemptions from or may impose additional standards beyond the requirements. I have a problem with the exemptions. If the chief wants to add additional restrictions in terms of the water supply or what needs to be done for fire, I don't have a problem with that, but I do have a problem if they have the ability to exempt someone from this ordinance. And that's essentially what this says. The chief or his or her designee can exempt somebody. Yeah, boss.
To tell you the truth, Rich, I don't like to exempt anything, because once you set an ordinance and you put exemption, it's ordinance to me is
great. Yep.
But I think the reason we did that is because we were trying to come up with a way, if somebody put in a 6 or 7 lot house developed and across the street there was already a dry hydrant, then there would be no requirement as far as I'm concerned. I'd like the fire chief should have that option to not require a cistern or a pond or anything, because it's already existing. I think that's what we were looking at, something like that. But, I mean, I understand what you're saying, but I'm not a big person on exemptions, because, like I said, it's a lot easier when it's just cut and dry. But I do understand what you're saying. But I think that's what we were looking at. I'm trying to remember our conversation when Tad and I and Randall said I'm talking about it. I think that's where we were going with it, was that we weren't really looking to make it less than. The only problem is, it's like anything else. It's when you designate it to the fire chief and or designee, every fire chief has their own opinion.
Right.
And that could be the issue you're discussing.
That would be the issue,
yeah.
I would have. Because
yeah, and we had the same problem. We weren't sure how we were going to work with that.
Yep.
So, but.
I would rectify it simply by taking, oh, by the way, Tom, it's in here twice.
I have.
Okay. Number twice, the same way I looked at it. Really? Okay. I would simply say that the fire chief or his or her designee may impose additional standards beyond the requirements.
That, what, you know, whatever you
that's,
plan board does.
That, and that's just my thought on it. These guys may have a different one.
To go with what the chief is saying, just to expound on that if you don't mind, Chief.
No, go ahead.
The problem was when we're coming up with certain standards, I mean, if we look at the dance that is called the authority section, mm-hmm. where we're trying to provide balance here, there are certain circumstances, as the chief said, where somebody's going to be in that, let's say, 4 to 7, let's say an 8-lot subdivision. 8-lot subdivision, you're automatically required to put in residential fire protection water supply.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, that's the way it is. I think we had talked about 10, Chief. We can go with 10 if you want. But
yeah, yeah.
The problem was that with anything over 8, it has to be a subdivision.
Yeah.
And that's kind of when things get real serious with planning board. But you know, the number is arbitrary, quite frankly. And that's what it is.
So 8 is consistent with a road standard?
And
leave it at 8.
That's what I'm saying. But in that situation, if you have, as the chief said, if you've got, how do we deal with a situation where I've got subdivision on this side that's 10 lots, and it's across, and there's another subdivision, they put it in a cistern, and another subdivision goes across the street, and it's 4 lots, or it's 8 lots too. You're using the same cistern. Why do they have to put in a whole new water supply that's only feet away, 50 feet away, or 25 feet away?
So with that, I would add some language into 577 that says the fire chief, may provide an exemption due to
proximity
of an existing water supply, or something
right.
like that, that really, really makes it specific to
Thief.
To what the exemption would be called for.
So. Site conditions, topography, isolation, fire loads, explosions.
Right there.
available water proximity.
So, okay, so the way I read this was you had, may provide exemptions without much information or impose additional based on all this other stuff.
So I could separate those.
Yeah, maybe so.
See, I think I would agree with you, say that the exemption would be if there is proximity to an existing water supply.
Adequate existing water supply.
Yep. So maybe we should.
Yeah, okay.
All right, so maybe we'll just reverse the language here, chief, and start off with that.
Well, I think these
circumstances.
I think we had discussed that of trying to come up with an adequate water supply. The problem was it was hard to pinpoint. There again, everything's based on the type of construction, the fire load, so it was hard to determine exactly how we wanted to word it. But I mean, if you leave it as a ample water supply, then I mean, with the fire load calculations and stuff, you can come up with somewhat of a standard.
So would that be, may provide exemptions based on ample water supply?
Yeah, I would say, I would reword it that based on factors such as site conditions, topography, isolation, fire loads, exposures, and proximity of available water supply, the fire chief may provide exemptions or may impose additional standards. Does that work better?
I'm all right with it, but back to what you're saying, that exemptions or additional standards could be, you know, you like this guy or not, not you, but it could be.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so
that's why I would say the exemption would be the proximity to an adequate water supply.
Right.
That's the exemption that the chief would be able to exercise.
Yeah.
Other than that, he could put in additional standards and make people.
And if challenged, you could say, well, that there is ample supply or whatever. Yeah. It's whatever that decision is based on.
It takes it out of the arbitrary and capricious, well, the chief just doesn't like me, so he wouldn't let me do it.
Maybe I'm under the assumption that no matter who the chief is, if an exception is made, that it still has to be approved by the board. Is that correct?
Well, not necessarily.
Well, then there needs to be a fail-safe in there for that reason, so that, because if I don't like Terry or whatever, then I could say, I'm going to require it.
How could you not like Terry?
Well, no, I'm just saying. I mean, just so I then
I hear that a lot about
then I have an issue that we need to protect that from
you. Yeah, chief, do you really want the planning board to be able to overrule your decision making?
Well, no, not necessarily.
I don't think that's a good idea.
But I mean, you.
Well, we have the ability to, but we choose not to.
Not if it's part of the ordinance. Yeah, I don't think we should be able to overrule.
And that's fine. I'm just saying that is something that you need to. I mean, you made the point. It's something that somebody down the road, but maybe. If that's the case, if somebody is fingering somebody else, then maybe that falls under the fire chief working for the town and would fall under the town manager's jurisdiction to say, hey, bonehead, you can't do that because, all the board.
Yeah, we don't hear all about the boneheads.
Okay, well, whatever. So all right. I just think there needs to be, make sure there's checks and balances all the way through. So.
Other than that, I liked.
Have we had any conversation on 5.7.2 in the exemptions from B, seasonal rectory, that residents occupied less than 6 months of calendar year? Mm. Because the seasonal is now 8, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Would we want to make that consistent?
Your sprinkler chains.
Well, I'm not worried about that. Those ones. Well, I'm not worried about that. I'm thinking more of a new one.
Well, actually, it's seasonal residence. It's not seasonal cottage.
This is in work, so.
What is right? It? Okay.
Feel free.
Do it be in or the camp people?
It'd be camp.
Camp.
So,
yeah.
So why? Okay. Why is that not as important as any other residence?
You said because of limitations in the structure?
Well, no, you could have seen the rest of the section, see 6 months in Arizona.
But the, all right, so the authority on this then would, you'd have to have a subdivision full of camps?
Basically. At this point, our seasonal residence has kind of gone out the window.
Where could we possibly get a subdivision full of camps in Arundel? I'd be afraid to find out. Out on Curtis Road, out in the Great Arundel Swamp.
Why wouldn't that include chips on it? Why wouldn't it include seasonal cottages?
Well, there's.
Seasonal cottages?
No.
What's the difference between a seasonal cottage and a seasonal residence?
Definition.
Yeah. Is the definition that says seasonal residence?
And seasonal cottage.
Okay.
I think you wrote it.
I didn't know it was one for residence.
I just was,
Did I write that?
6 months is fine.
I actually, I think at this point.
Consistency.
At this point, would you agree, Chief, that that's kind of a, we wrote that originally when we were gonna go with sprinkler systems.
Yeah, but I don't even know if it needs to be in it.
I don't think it does.
I mean, why is a, you know, whether it's occupied 6 months out of the year or all year, it's a structure. I mean, it really doesn't matter one way or the other, it's hard work.
I agree.
So we probably shouldn't even exempt it.
Okay, so we don't exempt that. What about replacement structures? Now, bear with me, I'm thinking that replacement structure, okay? I currently have a house that did not burn, that burns to the ground and is not covered. I can rebuild it, I still don't have to provide adequate water supply. There's a reason it burned to the ground.
Individual, I mean, if your individual house, you don't live in a development, so no, you wouldn't have to do that.
Okay, I live in a mobile home, I wouldn't have to do it anyway.
Yeah. So, I'm not even sure why we put that in, to tell you the truth.
Well, we put it in there, I think the issue here is, you know, I'm glad they brought this up, Chief.
Well, we were hoping it would get some discussion.
Actually, remember, this was put in, if you remember, Chief, we put this in when we were talking, when you guys were talking about mandatory sprinkler systems.
Oh, right, yeah.
And they're saying, you can't put a sprinkler system in a mobile home.
Right.
And it doesn't make sense putting in a camp or a structure that's not occupied. And then replacement structures, if you have a house or you have a building and it's being replaced, should that person now have to put in a sprinkler system?
Well, if my house burned down, I know the next one would have sprinklers in it.
What if it didn't burn down? What if it didn't burn down?
I'd still want to have a safe
house. What if the brook overflowed and carried
out? Well, I don't know, there again, I don't know if that should be in there because, you know, we're not, the way it is now is it's falls, the sprinklers, to me, fall under the, after sitting down with Tad and Randall, and I said, you know, as far as I'm concerned, the sprinklers should be an option, along with the cisterns and the pond. It's to me, it's, my preference, to me, it's the least likely to cost the taxpayer anything in the future is a sprinkler system. Because we're finding now when we put in hydrants 20 years ago that we're starting to have to repair them. Unfortunately, Arundel is excellent because they have a public works that does a lot of work for us. But I didn't know 25 years ago when we were putting hydrants all over the, you know, county that they were going to stop falling apart. So what happens is that who pays for them? Well, by 25 years later, all the taxpayers in the town are paying for them. Well, the thing with the sprinklers to me is that the taxpayers in the town shouldn't ever have to pay for them. It's a one-shot deal. But, you know, there again, to make it mandatory, I don't think we're there yet. So that's why I suggested let's just make it an option.
Yeah, I would.
My preference would be to say to somebody, yeah, go with the sprinklers because it isn't going to cost the taxpayers anything down the road. But that's not my call. I think the people there should make that decide how they want to go. Keeping in mind, the planning board's got to keep in mind that somewhere down the road, that ponds and cisterns will probably cost taxpayers in the town something. Not much, but there could be some costs down the road.
Well, what's the life expectancy of a concrete cistern these days?
I don't know.
Or even a polycarb system. Because they will wear out eventually. So
so.
I mean, we have trouble with the hydrant, I mean, you know, we're looking, I think we stipulated a year ago with steel, but steel hydrant.
Concrete culvert.
Concrete septic tank, that lasts.
Thirty, 40 years.
Yeah, but if you look at a development that we talked about earlier, that has some in-ground cisterns, they leak. The very first ones in there don't hold water anymore, and they've only been in the ground for 10 years.
And I know they're going with the poly cisterns and stuff now, I don't know a lot about them. You know, concrete seems to thing, I know they're not cheap. I haven't, you know, 10 years or so ago, I was up to Fred Roberts and looked at the tanks and stuff they use, but I haven't been up there for a long time to see. Other than I know our PVC hydrants, it doesn't take much to break them somewhere, and the ground moves or whatever, so those.
Kids coming.
Well, that's why you requested everything be metal.
Question on that, what you had brought up.
Yep.
On those cisterns.
Concrete.
Were those poured cisterns?
Concrete.
No, well, no, or were they?
Ten to one.
Or were those,
That's what.
One unit type cisterns?
I don't know.
Only reason I'm asking is that because if you're poured cisterns like a basement, if you don't butt walls together or anything else, you have a tendency to leak and crack along the way.
The only time I've seen, concrete cisterns leak is when the seal is not put in properly. They come in two pieces.
Right.
First piece goes in, there's a rubber seal that goes on, then they set this down and they fill it. If that seal gets turned or anything, then it will leak. And we had that experience in Berwick when I was there, we had to repair, tear one up and repair it.
Yeah, I have no idea what kind of cisterns are in there. I know we went out one day to test them and they were empty.
Only reason I'm asking that is because if we have future development in this particular project, even though they're in and they're not working, what good are they for infrastructure? I mean, where do we find that out? Answering, I mean, infrastructure is there, but if it's not working,
so
I mean, I just.
And I understand that, and I don't know the answer to that. I know that we're giving them a choice of concrete or polycarbonate, so they have to have a cistern. I want to go back just to the exemptions. Are we agreed that the only one that's going to be in there is mobile homes?
Yeah, as far as I understand. Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. I want to make, let's make sure we tie that all up. And.
But not mobile home parks. We should make that specification.
We shouldn't even exempt mobile homes, as far as I'm concerned.
If you treat a mobile home park is a subdivision.
It is.
Therefore, it should be out of here completely. That entire, there should be no exemptions.
Right.
Okay, good point. I hadn't thought about.
Do they have their own regulations that override what we have? I thought like mobile home park has, might have different sets of restrictions.
Well, you have different set of standards and ordinance for a mobile home park.
I thought the state, I agree with you, I thought the state had something on mobile home.
The state does, and we basically, we have similar, we've tweaked them ours, but it's pretty much the same.
So we say there are no exemptions?
Right, I agree with the chairman, it's.
Yeah, that works for me.
Yeah, I think originally when we were talking about the sprinkler system, that was something we were interested in, but I think now there should be none, absolutely.
So I want, if we're looking at the authority. Yes, sir.
You're going to sprinkle a trailer?
No.
We're not.
No. We're just, this is talking about whether or not you can have an exemption from having a fire pond or a cistern or something in a mobile home trailer park. And we're saying you must have something, some kind of fire protection in the park.
We're actually not telling anybody they have to sprinkle.
Because there's no way you're going to sprinkle a mobile home. Not going to happen.
Oh, I know that. That's why I asked.
No. I can't get there fast enough to put a mobile home on, so.
Yeah. That's true. It wouldn't make any difference.
Yeah. You have to be next to it.
Yeah.
So this applies strictly to subcorrections.
Yeah.
And commercial buildings.
And commercial buildings. Yeah. And
commercial buildings in excess of 4,000 square feet.
Yep. If I'm looking at this, residential subdivisions, regulated by 30 MRSA, okay, consisting of 8 lots or more, or between four and seven lots. What about three lots?
Exempt.
Three lots are exempt?
Yeah.
I want to find out.
Three lots, they will be, your ordinance does not apply.
I don't know.
It does.
Current subdivision would require a 65,000 gallon cistern to be put in for a three lot subdivision.
Which we felt was excessive.
I have a question, Chief. This, is it, if you have in front of you, 5.7, right at the top, 1B, it says anything located more than 2,500 linear feet from a designated operational water supply. Is 2,500 feet, 2,500 feet, is that reasonable, in your opinion? How long of a, you'd have to have hoses going 2,500 feet?
Yeah, and that's what we carry.
Okay.
Yeah, but...
With the 5-inch hose that we carry now, that we can, I can lay 2,500 feet from a water source, and with two trucks, I can pump ample water.
Okay.
Okay, and that's the advantage of, it was before I got here when they went with the large diameter hose. And that, actually, it was less than that, and when we talked about the other day, we increased it to match out to what we have for, what we have in Arundel for hose. Now, we got more hose coming in, but that's the max I would like to go with the two trucks we have. And yes, that's well within our range.
That's 5-inch hoses with 6-inch fittings, right?
No, it's just 5-inch hoses.
And that's got 5-inch sports on it?
Yes.
So why am I putting 6-inch fittings on the hydrants?
Because our dry hydrants have to be tied into our suction, which is 6-inch.
Oh, that's right. Sorry.
Duh.
Never mind. I'm stuck on three unit subdivision.
Where are you on that?
It's not on here. We don't have to move it. They don't have to do anything from a fire point of view on a three unit subdivision.
Do you question why four and not three?
Yes.
I thought that was something Tad came up with, but I don't mean to throw you under the bus, but...
Well, you just did.
I thought the subdivisions or something in the town started like at four or something. I mean, it doesn't matter to me where we go three, four, six, maybe.
I think it was because we have family divisions. Let's understand the difference between the two here. Rather than going through all the explanation, that's why I've got the parentheses there. The chief the chief's concern was there's a lot of subdivisions that occur here that don't go through the planning board. And that in some cases those need to have water supply.
Mm-hmm.
Now, a lot of those, and that's what 30 MRSI, or MRSA, 4401, that's what the second one is. That's the exemption for probate, for family divisions and probate, and for incremental divisions. So it's basically, those the chief is concerned that those have no water supply. We have a large piece of land that is being divided up among probate, and there's going to be like 15 lots in there, and there's no requirement for water supply because it doesn't go through subdivision. The chief is saying those aren't exactly exempt from fire protection needs.
Will this address that issue?
But I think, now that you mentioned it, Tad, I think the three came from because... I had mentioned that, and I wasn't sure how Arundel was, that if I own a piece of property, I can give two pieces of property to my daughter and my son, and they can build on it, and that's three houses, but that doesn't require a cistern and everything like that. My concern is that if there's multiple 100 acres, how many times can they do that before we end up with 10 or 15 houses on one road? And I don't know if there's anything we can do about that. I mean, family is family, so I mean,
well, under the current way, chief, I mean, you know, to prevent 10 or 20 or something like that, that's why we had the 8-lot threshold there. You know, the 4 and the 7 were for small family divisions, basically. Yeah. And Yeah, it's for, actually, it would apply to all subdivisions, but most of our family divisions are three.
Yeah, and that's what I thought.
If you do have family divisions, they never go over seven.
Right, but, and I thought that's where the three come from, because I said if somebody wanted to give a son and daughter, and it's a family, even though it's, to me, it doesn't, it's not a subdivision more. Or maybe it is, I mean, I don't know what the.
Technically, it's not a subdivision by, that these guys regulate.
Right, and I just.
It's exempt from their review, but it has to meet all zoning standards.
Right, and I didn't see where it was worth having somebody have to put money, a lot of money into cisterns and stuff like that for a family type.
And that's also why you put in if there's a water supply for any subdivision, if there's a water supply within a half a mile, basically, that you can get a water shuttle going. Why nobody needs to put in any, even if it's seven units.
Yeah, I think the trick is there, and I don't, do we have it in there? It should say adequate water supply.
What time of year? This year, what?
Yeah, this year would be fine.
You're right, it doesn't say adequate. Well, it says 15,000 gallons.
All right.
At least 15,000.
Yeah, that's fine, that's in there.
That's what it was.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay, so you're saying that the three units is because of the concept of a family subdivision?
I think that's my theory on it, Rich, I'm not sure of that.
Which I can understand, but we have a lot of people who want to put in, who may want to put in a three-unit subdivision that has nothing to do with family. They just have enough land, and they could sell off 2 acres and put some houses in there, or 2 lots, like, I can't think of the guy down on the Old Post Road that we looked at.
Terrio.
Thank you.
He put in a 20,000 gallon.
He did, because we told him to, but under this ordinance, he's not gonna have to do anything.
But he's also within a half a mile of water supply.
He doesn't have to do anything anyway. It should say that, that's why I would think that you would have three instead of four. You would start at three, which is the where the subdivision starts, and you move up from there.
It would be consistent.
You're talking about Mr. Terrio, I mean, his first subdivision that he put in a fire pond.
Yes.
That's what I was gonna bring up.
Yep.
This is gonna be a maintenance nightmare between cisterns, fire ponds, because you've got fire ponds out there right now that are just all weeded in.
Yep.
And ain't worth crap.
Yeah, okay. Absolutely.
So, you guys are gonna have to decide, if you guys are gonna make everybody put these in, who's gonna maintain them?
Yep.
Because they've gotta be maintained.
That's right, that's a serious issue.
And
but it's an issue that's not being addressed.
Yeah.
Tell me how to address it.
We can.
Why put them in then, if it's gonna be a maintenance nightmare?
That's why his song didn't go with a pond.
Right.
His song of a cistern.
Yeah.
See, that's, they were looking at ponds and they decided not to because of the maintenance.
Right, and that's why I said, if you ask me, I would recommend you put in sprinklers. Because there is, the only maintenance to them is the homeowner. There's no fallback on the town. The problem is that it's relatively new, and you know, not all the people think it's a good idea. They say, well, it's expensive. Well, you know, it's no more than putting in a cistern that you gotta maintain down the road. But as far as I'm concerned, if a homeowner puts the sprinklers in, there's no cost to the taxpayer, or very little, ever. Okay, but if you put the ponds and stuff in, and you got weeds, you got backfill, I mean, you guys know, you guys down there helping us dig out hydrants and stuff, so. But, you know, to me, it's an option.
Phil?
I put a sprinkler system in my house, and I got no water. What good is a sprinkler system? So then you're gonna say, put in a cistern. Now you're hitting me double. And a cistern is anywhere from $30,000 to $60,000. You're killing some homeowners.
It would be a problem in a time of, in a year like this where we're having a drought, but most of the time it's going to be tied to your well and you're going to have water anyway.
But there's a drought all over the county, not only in Arundel.
Oh yeah.
Everybody's got water problems.
Yeah.
So, water problems, yeah, is a water problem.
You're right, it is.
True of a fire pond.
And it doesn't matter.
If the fire department pulls in, chances are within 5 minutes or less after the first truck gets there, there's going to be three more.
Oh yeah.
There's 3,000 to 5,000 gallons of water right there. And if that doesn't put my fire out, take your trucks and go home, let it go.
Well, and that was what I remember, the conversation on the sprinkler system as being more of a life safety measure than a property saving measure.
Yeah, they're not designed sprinkler system with no water.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
Not gonna save any lives, right.
But you know, and he's right. I won't disagree with that, but if you have no water, then you've got a pump problem, you've got a power problem, or you've got a drought problem.
You got a maintenance problem from the homeowner that doesn't do what he's supposed to do.
That could be too, but if you've got a drought problem, that's Mother Nature. So are you saying that because 2 years ago you guys plowed snow for 3 weeks straight, that you can plan on that? And then last year you didn't plow nothing? How can you say something that nature is gonna, hell yeah, you may run out of water, but that's nature. You can't plan for that.
Exactly.
You know, so I mean, you can have a pond, you can have as many as you want.
But a system will always guarantee that you'll have water.
That's right.
You get some now that are dry.
Well, that's right. You know, I'm not saying that, you know,
it's easier to put water in those than inspect those than it is a pond. And there's really no maintenance that you have to do on it except fill it, right?
Well, you've got a cistern in the ground that leaks.
Right, it's the maintenance.
You'll have to reline it.
But then you got, you know, people break hydrants off, I mean heads, and you know, you know, there's maintenance to everything, no matter what you do.
My next question would be, how many homeowner well pumps are strong enough to supply a sprinkler system?
Actually, that's the way they design them now. I was just on the fire marshal's office. They make them to run off household well supplies. That's the way they make them now. They run right off a regular well.
And the intent is just that initial to get people out of the building?
Yeah, they're not designed to save the building. They're designed to get
you. They're not the ones where you had to have the 300-gallon storage tank in your cellar. These are all run right off the household well. In fact, I was just reading an article by the fire marshal. And, you know, it's a life safety thing. The other thing is that I kind of look at it this way, and I'm not telling anybody they have to put sprinklers, and I don't think we should make them mandatory. I think it's an optional thing. But the fire department is tasked with trying to protect life and property. So if I got a sprinkler and it holds the fire for 5 minutes, it doesn't put it out, but it keeps it in one room, kind of. That gives my guys, all two of them, on the truck to get there and try to put the fire out in that one room. If it's not there, then I'm still going to come down, but now the fire may be in two rooms, and you say, well, you got the pond and the cistern, but I got to lay a line from there. You know, I got... So I'm just saying...
But you know that on a structure fire, you may have those two guys, but you've got probably five other towns coming right behind you.
It's true.
All mutual aid.
It's true.
All automatic response.
It's true.
All eight to
but it all takes time to get there. And I'm just saying the sprinkler is, as soon as the fire hits it, it's flowing. Now the people may not even make the phone call yet. So it's already doing its job. And like I said, I'm not going to say that everybody has to put a sprinkler in. I'm just saying it's an option. If somebody asked me what my preference would be, I'd say put the sprinklers in. I think it's safer. It's not the answer.
And I agree with the chief. If I were king, I would say everybody sprinkles their house, but I'm not king. What we've done here is give you the three viable options for the developer to build. Do you want to put in a cistern? Do you want to put in a fire pond? Or do you want to sprinkle? You need to provide fire protection of some kind, other than just put up a house. We're going to put up a 15-unit. Well, I'll pick on Bartlett Farms. We're going to put up a 41-unit subdivision, and we're not going to put any fire protection in. That makes no sense either. We're simply saying you have to choose one of these three if you put in the subdivision. We don't care which one it is. Well, we might care, but the choice becomes yours as a developer. What do you want to do?
But, and Terry's right, because things have changed a little bit, because years ago, if he and I showed up on the fire scene with the fire truck, and we take the hose, deadhead the truck, and we go put the fire out.
Yep.
Well, you know as well as I do, the standard says you can't do that anymore. You can't attack a fire unless you've got four people there, unless there's somebody in the building. That's the way it is. And you say, well, you just do it if you get caught, then I'm gonna have to go explain to Dan why a town's getting fined some X amount of godly amount of money because I didn't follow the standards. So, you know, what's the other option? Put on more people. That's costly.
So let's go back and look at this ordinance. Are there anything else in here that you guys see?
It may not be the answer, but hey, look at it.
Yeah, Marty.
And then throw it.
What are they saying along the lines? What's the distance between fire hydrants?
It's in the commercial section, Mike. It's in, it's in section 5732, page 1.
5, 7.
Non-residential uses along Route 1?
Yep.
If they don't meet the sections of 5721, they shall install a dry barrel fire hydrant in the existing water line along Route 1. So they'll put in a hydrant if they don't meet the other criteria.
What's the distance along Route 1?
1,000 feet. 5721 says 1,000 linear feet.
But just to add to that, Rich, and that goes to back what Terry was saying about the pulling and stuff, is that we can have these people put in a hydrant, but I believe the town has to pay, right? Don't you pay for the hydrants for a year?
Yep, $900 a year.
Huh?
$900 a year.
So, I mean, when we require somebody to put in a hydrant, and don't get me wrong, I want them to put in a hydrant, but, you know, we've got to consider the cost down the road.
It's cheap insurance.
I don't have a problem with that, and I agree with you, and I'd like to think the board would take care of it, but that is another option that you got, there's another cost involved here, so.
The initial installers, the developer, or the...
Right, absolutely. The only thing the town's gonna do is pay for it. And the other thing I look at, even though it's on a road, even though it's on a road into a private business, it's available for us to use anywhere, for anything. So that's the upside to it. But it doesn't matter, unfortunately, it doesn't matter what we do here. There's cost involved the best we can do here. The only thing I'm saying is we have a job to do with the fire department. If the planning board in the town can assist us in doing that by doing something like this at minimal cost, great. You know, if it doesn't, we're still gonna be there. We're still gonna do our job.
And frankly, Chief, this also is more reasonable for the homeowner because the current standard is the ISO standard.
That's outrageous.
It's just, oh, yeah. It's cost prohibitive.
Yeah, no, absolutely. If you got to put in 90,000 gallons, to, you know, that's ridiculous.
For a six-lot subdivision,
absolutely.
And, you know, Phil, you had a subdivision, six-lot subdivision, and the Chief had to, at the time, had to basically give a waiver on that because I think you had to have, like, otherwise you would have had to put in, like, an ungodly amount of...
Yeah, I think it was 30,000 gallons plus 5,000 additional per unit.
Yeah.
You're looking at 100 grand.
Yeah.
So there goes, oops, we're done.
Yeah.
We're out of here.
Yeah, that doesn't make any sense at all. So that's ridiculous.
So under this, you'd be looking at, well, you have a water supply within a half a mile.
Okay.
So you wouldn't have to do anything. Unless the chief thought your situation was bad and not there.
In the effort to speed this along,
there's for instance, on my subdivision, down the road to a minimum,
you know, there's a hydrant,
less than
section
a half,
like
a city hydrant,
right?
And right at my shop, which is an eighth of a mile,
so they would only be
we have a good-sized pond in back with a hydrant out at the road.
That's an artesian well pond, isn't it? That's fed by an artesian well, isn't it?
No.
It isn't.
No, it's spring fed from up in the woods.
Okay. That's, to me, that's
on one page
springs.
Two.
Another one, right?
Yeah.
B and C are identical.
Even now in the drought, that pond
interior
is...
Interior water extension. Remember everything? Just trying to make that all work.
How did KP On number two, about the 1,000 feet of roof, long roof line, where, how does that work if you're going into DB2?
No difference.
Look where it says DB2 right there.
No, what I'm trying to say is, your...
Water lines will add this.
That's what that...
Say for...
That's for the lateral, then interior water line extensions, go to number C on page two.
Okay, more than 1,000 feet from Route 1, shall construct water line extensions along the access roads, driveways, and private ways, and install dry barrel hydrants.
Okay, my question is, okay, it's 500 feet from the nearest hydrant.
Okay.
Okay, you're in between two, and you're going inward, okay? Where does it start and stop from your 1,000 feet? So if you're going inward...
500 feet.
It's along the road.
Because you're gonna be 500 feet from the hydrant, and then you're going in, and if you go in more than 500 feet, then you're gonna have to put in a lateral water line.
All measurements are by road. Because, you know, we're talking about laying hose here in many cases, and so it's by the roadway, it's not drawing big circles, it's the distance it takes to travel. That's why it says travel way on it.
Okay, and anything else that you guys see? And the only reason I'm asking is that if we can move this along, we can get it rewritten, and then we can schedule some kind of a public hearing or something to proceed forward.
The only big question, and I don't know if we could ever resolve it tonight, is the maintenance cost.
There's no
requirement, so in effect, 5 to 10 years later...
The town's going to end up with that cost.
Well, unless tonight you have a development in which you still have a homeowners association, right, and they have to maintain, or they have to have a kitty for your...
We can put that in there, we can say that. The reality is that the homeowners association's not going to do it.
No, they could have an escrow, but I'm saying if it's...
Who's going to place that?
Huh?
Who's going to place that?
Well, it's better than nothing.
Not if it's...
I guess I have a question. There must be other requirements of subdivisions. I mean, if you require them to build the road to a certain standard, and they bring it to the town and it's accepted as a town road, who maintains it?
The town does. Once it becomes a town road, it's...
The town's going to get all the infrastructure, including the drainage and the...
That's like we were talking about Bartlett Farms. They plan on coming to the town. They've already told us that.
But that pond at Terrio's across the street from me is just in open space.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. That's open space. That town don't own that.
See, when you do a pond and put hydrants in, I haven't done it here because I haven't put anything, but anything, when I was taught this years ago, you always got an easement from the landowner that said you have access to go in and repair it and fix it or whatever you need to do to it. And if they don't have those here, then unfortunately anything that's in that pond, if they don't have any kind of easement, we're screwed. Well, the other thing is, the problem is that if you don't have an easement, I don't think you can spend taxpayer money on private property, can you?
Yeah.
So we'd have to, you know.
Do you want an easement section in this as well? It's in the
subdivision. If you're going to put a hydrant in a pond somewhere or a brook that's on somebody's property, you've got to have an easement.
All right.
And it's got to be reviewed by legal to make sure it's legal.
So basically, if we require that in here, then we're taking responsibility for maintenance of all fire ponds.
Well, that's something we need to think about.
Why didn't it happen?
And that's what Terry was saying earlier.
I mean, it's not just fire ponds.
No, it's cistern sewer. You know, I mean, because technically, the cistern is on private property when you originally go in. So, I think it's. I mean, if the town's willing to take over, you know, $900 a year for a pressurized hydrant, then you know, I mean, is it too much to ask that maybe every 20 years you might have to? I mean, I don't know. I'd have to, you know, sit down and talk to Rangel and see what the cost. Well, Roger's been involved in redoing some of the hydrants, so I mean, And we've got hydrants now that because of the drought, they're just basically out of service. But it's a fluke of nature. When they recover, I don't know.
One thing we didn't hit fire ponds too hard, but I mean, Terry keeps bringing up a good point. Fire ponds are the least attractive solution to your water supply that we've got. Since it's so unattractive, is that something that...
We want to do away with?
You want to keep? Because, not because it's, I mean, it's can be done, and it's maybe cheaper, and you might get more water out of a fire pond, but we're looking at a maintenance time bomb for the town in the future. That's what you're saying, Terry.
Yeah, but no, what I'm saying is just the maintenance of it. I mean, I like sea fire ponds.
Yeah.
I mean, because they're there.
Right.
Especially if it's a pond that's already existing. Mm-hmm. If you can get permits to muck it out or do whatever you're going to do to get a hydrant in there, that's the cheapest way you can do it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I agree.
And for the applicant.
They're not ugly. I mean, a pond itself can be a very, very nice feature to the
development. They don't put the cyclone fence around it and all that stuff.
They've got to be maintained.
No, they do have to be maintained.
Absolutely.
That's right. And the problem is that's going to fall on the town. And it's going to fall on the town because, you know, I agree with Rich, the homeowners association, as you brought up, Ontario's property, nobody's maintaining that fire pond. Nobody will maintain that fire pond unless the town steps in.
But in order to do that, we've got the easement or a permission to be able to do that.
Right, so that's why I didn't put the easement in, because it commits us to do it.
But the other question too, Ergo also holds a liability for water safety. That is another point on your fire pond. If the town owns it or anything else.
They don't own it, they just have an easement to maintain it.
Right, yeah. They're not going to own the pond.
Right.
But where Marty's going is if, you know, we have a fire and somehow we miss the maintenance on that, now the town is liable for a lawsuit because they didn't maintain, if we missed one, are we opening ourselves up to...
Oh, absolutely. What, for kids around in it, right?
That's where they might have
my kids drowning in it.
We don't own the pond.
We don't own the pond. It's just an easement to the hydrant.
See, that's the problem that when I was in the mills, I ran into in a couple of developments, is they didn't want to put ponds in because they were going to have to put a fence up around it.
Right.
And even that, they were liable if the kids climbed over it, fell in and drowned. So right. That's why they went and started going with the cisterns.
Well, so I guess the question would then go to the selectmen. If we put in something in the ordinance in the subdivision that says that the homeowners association is responsible for maintaining the cistern or maintaining the fire pond and the hydrant, and something needs to be done, and Roger and the chief have to get together and go in and fix it, are you guys willing to go after the homeowners association? Because if you're not willing to chase down the homeowners association, it's a moot point as to who's responsible. The town becomes responsible.
It's private. You don't go in anyway because you're not spending public money.
Right.
Okay. Yeah.
You don't go in the first place to chase
the bill.
Well,
supposedly, I mean, if they give us an easement or whatever, that becomes
still private.
If it's private, are you guys willing to go after the homeowners association to make them fix whatever it is has to be done?
If your ordinance says that a subdivision has to have a cistern or a pond, and it needs to be, which it does,
and it needs to be maintained,
but that needs to be maintained by the homeowners association, then Roger's not going in there. It's going to be maintained by the homeowners association.
But what if they don't?
Yeah.
How are you going to enforce that? And that becomes the town's responsibility to go after the homeowners association and, if necessary, go to court to sue them for not fulfilling their responsibilities and their permits.
And that's my question. Will the selectmen follow through on that? Because we can put it in the ordinance. That's easy. I can put words on paper. Not a problem.
Getting it passed might be.
Yeah.
Getting it passed might be.
But it's easy to put in.
Right. Here's my question to you, Dan.
And Phil.
By Phil, I'm sorry, Phil. I look right by it because I'm just looking at my new game.
Phil's quite happy. Yeah.
I think somewhere along the line, we need some type of a legal interpretation that if we get a pond and we get an easement to maintain this hydrant, is the town going to be responsible for, you know, injuries, whatever, or how that's going to, you know, what the legal ramifications are. I mean, 10 years ago, I wouldn't worry about it. I mean, somebody like Phil gave us a new, we wouldn't worry about it. They just wouldn't, they probably wouldn't even care, but I mean, I
Can we get a legal opinion on that?
If you put a pond in, don't you bring the hydrant out to the right of way?
Yeah, but still, you got it, you may have access to the pond if it backfills or whatever.
But you can maintain your hydrant, because it's on the right of way.
The hydrant we can, it's...
The pond, if it's a homeowner association pond, and they don't take care of it, and somebody's house burns because of lack of maintenance in the pond, whoever's house burnt should sue the association.
Well, I know they should.
And I agree with that.
But guess who is gonna sue?
Coming to the town.
All right, here's the question.
They can sue you, but they can't...
No, but it would cost you legal fees.
Right?
And that's the problem.
Put it in the terms, you show them how to maintain everything.
Like in some type of formal agreement.
No, I'm just saying, maintain every 2 years, it's maintained this...
Who's gonna enforce it?
The possibility is zero.
The issue is enforcement.
And what, if you talk about trying to have it and enforceability, then you turn around, you don't have it at all, so there's no enforceability.
So that, Marty, that was my question to the selectmen. Will they pursue the issue with them if the association doesn't do what they're supposed to?
I don't think anybody's gonna do that.
You know what, nowadays, you know, 10 years ago, Phil, I agreed with you, but nowadays...
And I don't, I'm perfect.
I would tend to think they would.
I'm perfectly willing to put it in.
Maintain your hydrant.
What happens if you don't?
Then you can say if your house...
Well, no, I understand.
Or a legal budget for the year.
No, we have no different than...
Just don't say it in front of anybody, that's all.
It's no different than other enforcements that have come to us.
That.
We don't just want to deal with it, forget about it.
I can pretty much tell you what I'm going to do.
Legal counsel, and we drag it on for years and years.
That's right.
Yeah.
So we say, we don't want to do this anymore.
This is very sad that we have to sit around and discuss legally whether or not we can fix a hydrant. That's where we are.
Well, can you ask Leah that question? What kind of liability are we faced with if we put this in the ordinance? Does it open the town up for anything?
If we put what?
If we have a maintenance, a town maintenance of...
That's the even kind.
And that's the question, because if the answer is yes, then...
If the pond goes dry, somebody will call the town and say, gotta do something about my pond. It's dry, and my house is right here, and it might burn tomorrow.
Yeah, but turn of that, they might be sucking water off the pond too.
And that's the question. If we get an opinion from Leah, if Leah comes back and says, yes, the town is gonna be responsible, then guess what? It's gonna become a homeowners association responsibility to fix. We shouldn't saddle the town with all of that.
If the town has a legal obligation to maintain a pond,
Yep.
they're gonna be liable for the whole deal.
Yeah, I think we will.
No matter what happens there, the town will become liable.
And we don't wanna do that.
We ain't doing that.
When we look at the easement...
I agree with that. Not gonna be so...
When we look at the easement issue, that may be...
Not gonna happen.
Part of the problem. I mean, if Leah says that, yeah, you put in the easements, and you become responsible?
No.
We're doing that now.
50% is gonna be maintained.
But we can ask Leah just to make sure.
Two cattails are there.
Roger, we don't go after easements for the whole pond.
Can't, private property, can't do it.
Phil's subdivision, Phil granted us an easement for maintenance.
That's one of the only ones I...
The pond.
Yes.
Because you have to be able to do that in order to do the strainer.
But we have...
The strainer is part of the hydrant.
Yeah, and that's...
So you have to be able to get in there and clean out the strainer.
It gets buried on the silt, and that creates a problem.
You can't backflow it.
No, it doesn't.
Okay.
Well, you can.
You backflow it, and you back...
I think we've beaten this enough.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Ted, we've beaten this enough for this evening?
Yes.
We have some...
Really?
We have some...
We've beaten some other things before.
We have some...
Oh, we have, but...
Places to go.
Officially tonight.
Yes. I have one question.
We've made a good progress on this, and let's... find out what the attorney has to say.
Mr. Chairman, under 576, you're asking for road and parking design on one, and then two? Is two an incomplete sentence? I mean...
I don't know, I didn't write it.
On driveways.
Driveways with a travel way less than a uniform 15 feet in width, less than 400 feet. Where is that structure by... Oh, that says, that looks like the definition of a long driveway.
What do we do there?
I have no idea.
I have none either.
There's some language that's been left out, because originally, that sentence...
Yeah, I know what it said originally.
Turnouts every certain number of feet.
No, we didn't go with turnouts, but we went with a minimum width or maintenance. We never finished that.
Yeah, no, we did.
Okay, so...
We gotta fix that.
Thank you, Roger.
Where should tell Roger what it is? What is it designed? Do you remember what you decided, Chief, on that?
And back on the first one, all private ways, subdivision roads, private driveways. They're gonna provide adequate travelway with curb radii to accommodate 100-foot ladder truck. All private driveways? Really?
Only, that would only be in the subdivision. This whole thing is based on subdivision.
We didn't say that.
Yeah, it doesn't.
It says it in the authority.
In the authority.
So it's, again, some things we...
Yeah, we don't have tweaks or things.
Yeah.
No, it says that it only applies to things that qualify for this. That's all it applies to.
And this will be in the subdivision ordinance.
Yeah, no, I just...
Okay.
But I don't know, Chief, what you wanted to do with that long driveway.
Yeah, we'll probably delete it, but...
Probably will. We had talked about it.
No, I'm glad we're getting input.
Yeah, no, thanks for bringing that up, Roger. Okay, the question was, we wouldn't probably have, well, we talked about some long driveways and subdivisions.
Yeah, subdivision, private driveway.
Yeah, Mark.
Where is our punch list that I have requested?
I gave it to you. I saw
the list, and it's just the dates that we got the information in.
See you at the next one.
I don't have it with me, but I did see the list.
It's what, two pages, three pages?
We all set with it.
And it covers stuff that's, you know, 4 or 5 years old.
We're all done with the fire ordinance for tonight?
We're all done with the fire ordinance for now.
I'll see you.
All right.
We'll get together.
Tell me what you wanna do.
Yeah.
I'll fix it.
Yeah, we'll meet again.
Okay.
We're
gonna table the discussion for the schedule of amendments and stormwater management performance standards for tonight. But we're not gonna get to it. So do we have a planner's report? I guess not.
I don't have much to report. It's 2 weeks ago. Oh, I do have some. I can tell you a few updates and a couple of things. They're pointing to where I am, okay? I have had a couple of meetings with former SMRPC.
Somewhat.
And what they're looking at right now, Kennebunkport, Lyman, SMRPC is really taking the lead on this. We're going for 319 watershed management plan grant from the feds. And basically it's for coming up with a coordinated management of Kennebunk River. Very similar to what the Thatcher Brook stuff is.
We have a plan for the management of the Kennebunk?
No, we don't have a plan. It's what SMRPC is going to do is going for a grant in order to develop a plan for the Kennebunk River.
Should they not have, should they not have done that before we tore the dam up?
I think that's water over the dam.
Was Marty more water? Was he there for the meeting?
Were you there for this one, Marty?
This is a watershed plan. This is watershed. Which we in Kennebunk are the primaries. Kennebunk Port is part of it. Most of the important water quality problems come from there. And then we have the Lyman, which is as the headwaters. But that's in the works right now, that we're gonna be doing that. And we have a very extensive agenda coming up next meeting. We have a full agenda again.
Okay.
Not including the stuff that we, that's going from this agenda to the next. It looks like lot three might be, there might be a resolution for that, Leo told me, so they'll be out. In fact, they have to, we have to act at the next meeting.
Or they have to give us an extension?
And Leo tells me that they have an agreement where they're just going to pay for it, so it looks like that's gonna go forward.
Leo's a neighbor, right?
Yes.
Leo's the neighbor, right. Yeah, Mr. Morrow.
That's where the public water is going away from the well.
Yeah, I just wanted to make sure. He wasn't the applicant.
Okay. There's also fines.
It's good to hear that the agreement seems like it's going forward from the neighbor.
Oh, you mixed them all up. It's great. Two copies, there's two copies. Just do one copy.
Draws a clean water.
So, that's pretty much all I've got right now. We've got almost finalized the contract with Ray Pierce for the sewer preliminary study. And we're starting the next week. And I'm gonna have to be doing some work with them on coming up with development scenarios for the target area.
Yeah.
Question, Abrilatic, Commerce one, will they have time yet to build that for this?
Don't know.
With this one?
Atlantic Mini Storage, findings of fact.
I wasn't here.
You're right, sorry.
I missed the meeting in between, and maybe it was already discussed, and if it was, we'll have to just say yay or nay, but it was a discussion a while back on planner's report. Something was brought up on a planner's report that had taken, it had been there for months, and it was just,
Okay, I know what you're talking about.
Did that get discussed with the board?
It's on our bucket list of things that have to be done. When that showed up, it was a question about allowing, a non-accessory apartment in an R1 zone. We were working on other parts of the ordinance, so we just had to decide until we got through the stuff that we were working on. We now have a bucket list that shows us when these requests came in, and we're going to address them by the date that the request came in. And there are requests ahead of that one that we have not looked at.
Yeah, so I mean, you know, it's key when somebody comes in, and it doesn't take 3 or 4 or 5, 6 months to look at, right?
Yeah.
I mean, and I think the discussion was, the planner, the planner had some discussion with this individual on what was going on, and in my eyes, the planner should be telling you folks this, because this is his report, right? It doesn't have to be on the agenda. This is his report, but he says, hey, Joe Blow came in here, this is what we want, we've had this discussion, and then you guys at that point make the determination, great, good, thank you very much, or you know what, we need to bring this up and put this on an agenda item, or, you know, I mean, when people outside come in and ask for these things, he didn't let them sit, but you guys, I think you guys should know about it. Way ahead of time.
In this case, that is my fault, because I told him to hold it while we continue to work on the stuff that we were currently working on. He has since pulled that, from my understanding, is that he has said, yeah, he's not going to pursue that.
No, he just wanted to postpone it.
Okay.
He thanked the board for putting it on the agenda. It was sooner than he expected.
Because he was going out of town.
That's right.
In my opinion, any applicant that comes in for whatever, if he wants to park his car on the other side of the street, needs to be heard. Okay. We're not New York City here. We're around over 4,000 people. How many people can you have coming in asking for something minor, and my opinion, it shouldn't take the planning board very long to make a decision, yes, you can do this, or no, you can't, end the story.
In this particular case, it would not have been a minor change. We would have had to have rewritten a section of the ordinance to allow what he wants to do. It's in an R1 zone, and he wanted to have more than one residence on a lot that is allowed. So we would have to have amended the zoning ordinance itself and then gone before the town to get that accomplished.
Shouldn't the applicant be allowed to come in and be explained that through the planning board, that this is the reason we're not hearing you, you gotta do this, this, and this, and then we can hear you?
Okay.
Or flat out, what you wanna do is not allowed.
Okay.
And I'm not just speaking of this one particular person. I'm saying anybody that comes in, you know, if I come in and I wanna put a doghouse in back of my garage, I wouldn't want the planning board or the planner to say, we don't have time for you right now. We'll see you in 3 months. That's not what I'm in this town for, so to speak.
Okay, point taken. I could actually, yeah, I understand what you're saying. Okay.
Because I think, correct me if I'm wrong, I think I'm hearing right now that there may be several applicants out there that are not being heard. Did I just hear that?
No, we've heard the other issues. We had somebody come and say they wanted to put in a doggy daycare, or
they wanted to change the pet daycare ordinance so that it would be in a different zone than where it's allowed. Everything that they're talking about are ordinance changes. There are people who are asking to change the ordinance, and terrific, great.
Yeah, but the people that are asking for this, are they getting a thorough explanation of why they're not being heard?
I believe most of them did.
They're aware of the ordinance as it is now, so when they're coming into TAD, they know that it's not part of the ordinance.
And the reason why the planning board knows is because I always have them write a formal letter to the planning board, which I present to the planning board, and the planning board and says, okay, we'll put it on the bucket list of things that we've got to do for ordinance changes.
But this particular issue that we're talking about, you guys, there are a bunch of members on this board that didn't know anything about it until 5-6 months or so down the road.
About 4 weeks ago.
What's that?
Until about 4 weeks ago.
Right, it was 5 months or so down the road that it was brought up.
And
my point is that TAD, that's his report. His thing of the planner's report is, Joe Blow came to me this week and, you know, this is what we've got going. You know, we got a bunch of planning, you know, you guys at that point can make that decision, yeah, we'll put it on the bucket list. This guy came to me and wants to put a doghouse. This guy came to me and wants, that's his report. He's to report to you guys what's come across his desk. Not 6 months down, and I'm not blaming him. You know, you guys got a lot of stuff going on, and we certainly appreciate everything that's going on, but he ought to be coming to you and saying, this is what has happened. You guys make the determination when you want to work on it, but at least the applicant knows that the planning board has heard it. And if the planning board has, and the applicant has some questions, then he can come to the planning board and not ask a planning board member. A planning board member says, geez, I don't know, I haven't heard nothing about it. And he submitted that 6 months ago. I'm using arbitrary numbers. I don't know the exact numbers, but just, you know.
Okay, I got a question then.
Yeah, Mark.
In our case, and I've asked, Amably Husbandry.
It's on the list, Marty. We've told you it's on the list.
It's a three-phase power, number one.
Why do you move on?
Quit making fun. This is somebody in town. This is somebody in town.
Have you guys addressed
who wants it? Turn around about animal. You want to keep it rural and cultural and everything else, and you can't even have that. It's on the bucket list, but how long is the bucket list gonna go?
Marty, the only person I have heard from in this entire town questioning animal husbandry is the person I'm looking at right now.
Okay.
I have not heard from a single citizen that, other than you, that wants to talk about animal husbandry.
It's been put on, we told him point blank, he only can turn around and put 5 cows on 80 acres.
And why did we tell him that, Marty? And he was here. And why was he told that?
It's not important enough?
Well, in that case, we did discuss it with him.
And then why don't we turn around, we're waiting on somebody else to make a decision for us? The comprehensive plan?
Not waiting on the comp plan. We addressed the issue, we told him why, we told him what it was.
But how many years is it gonna take?
How late do we wanna stay here?
I'm just asking a question.
Marty, you're the one who wants out of here at 9:00 every week. So don't stand, sit there and say to me, how long's it gonna take us to make a decision?
I've been at every meeting, I haven't missed a lot of meetings. So don't tell me I haven't been sitting here till 9:10.
I agree, you have not missed a lot of meetings, you make every one of them.
Okay, is it, motion to adjourn?
We're done.
Could I throw something in just for the record?
Absolutely.
No, shut it off, I'd rather have it that way.
I'm hopeful.
Not every night you get thrown under the bus, quite.